Hello, it's no secret that when an operator gets into the cab every morning, he faces a lot of responsibility. Not just the productivity that he needs to achieve on the worksite, but also all the obstacles and hazards that are out there on a daily basis. That's why together with Xwatch Safety Solutions and Leica Geosystems, we've come up with a solution to add an extra layer of defense for operators out in the field. So the solution we will show you today is for a single boom excavator fitted with Leica MC1 3D machine control, dual GNSS setup. And alongside that, we have the XW5 height and slew limiter solution. And that's what we will base today's videos on. So before we go out and see the solution in action, there's a few key points that I'd like to point out and some terminology in relation to this the solution that we would like to discuss. One being avoidance zones. What is an avoidance zone? An avoidance zone is an area where we don't want the machine to be. So avoidance objects can be any objects that have been staked out on the site. So this is really just a virtual location that has been given points or measured out in the site in a virtual 3D world. And again, these objects are anything that we want to avoid or not make contact with out in the real world. When it comes to understanding the solution, we refer to what we call trigger points within the solution. Now, trigger points are points on the machine when the machine has been measured up and calibrated that we actually calculate in relation to these 3D, models or designs. And for that reason, it's really important for an operator to understand where these trigger points are on the machine. And we will get into this into more detail later on. For any more details of the solution, we have a very detailed application note that can be found on My World, and it would be best practice for any operator using the system to go through this documentation thoroughly. But enough about the theory and the talking. Let's get out and see this machine in action. So now that we're in the machine, let's give it a go and see how this solution works. So as you can see, in MC1, we have an avoidance model that has already been preloaded and the system is already pre-configured. So what I would like to do is I'd like to demonstrate to the audience how the system works when it is set up according to how I feel it should work for an operator in this scenario. So now that we are in the machine and we are carrying out our daily activity, in the top Xwatch display, it's very clear to see that we have entered an avoidance entry or an avoidance zone. Basically what this means, and it's very visual in MC1, right here you can see that the curb line in the background has been marked off with a red avoidance model, what we call a virtual wall. What I'd like to do is I'd like to demonstrate to you how the machine behaves when approaching that wall. So basically, when I slew towards the wall, I will feel a ramp down on the hydraulics and the machine will slow down until we reach the limit, which is known as the avoidance limit. This means we have triggered the avoidance limit. For the case of this video, I've just acknowledged that avoidance, but basically this is where the operator has a decision to make. He's reached a limit, and that means that's an area on the site where you shouldn't be going. So best practice, of course, would be to retreat away from the model. As you can see, as soon as you have retreated, everything resets and your avoidance becomes active again. This means as I pull in, I will increase my power as I'm moving in. As soon as I move out, the hydraulic power will ramp down again. Once I reach the avoidance limit, the alarm will be triggered. Just another demonstration to show, as soon as I've moved away, you can see how the model changes color. And of course, the further I get away from the model, the more my power will increase on a proportional basis. And for that, that's the very basics of how the avoidance system works in principle. And from here, we will show you a little bit about how tuning the settings can make the system perform according to how the operator or user would like to use it. So let's take a look at the avoidance settings and what they mean. So in MC1, I go to the main menu. In the projects file, I select my active project and we have a menu called avoidance zone. Once I'm in the avoidance zone, I have the models that can be selected, but the important part for this video is to understand the settings in terms of how the behavior of the system will work. So we have three main settings on this page, and this will be your extended triggers, your distance, and the creep or ramp up power that will be applied. I think for the case of this video, let's start with the very simple one. As you can see, we have a trigger distance red, which is over here. At the moment, this is set at 1 meter. We have a yellow distance, which in this case is set at 10 meters. Basically, what this means is that wherever the avoidance model has been loaded, the red distance will be where we tell the Xwatch controller to stop the machine. So this means you have reached the limit in terms of where you want to go. In terms of the yellow distance, this means that in the period between the 10 meters and the 1 meter, this is where we proportionally ramp down the hydraulic power of the machine. If we have a look at the trigger above and trigger below, what this does is if we have a simple line as a reference or as an avoidance model, what we can do is we can extend that line in infinity above or below that line or point. So essentially, if you just have a curve outline, you can say trigger above. By turning that on, it will extend the line in infinity. So it will essentially make a virtual wall out of the line. And this would be exactly the same in reverse by using the trigger below option.
The last part of the settings are the red and yellow creep percentages. They determine how much hydraulic power the machine can use when it is working in the yellow avoidance zone. The yellow creep percentage is effective just within the yellow zone, while the red creep percentage is effective right before the red zone. As an example, when the yellow percentage is 100% and the red percentage is 0%, the hydraulic power will decrease from 100% to 0% as you get closer to the red zone. In some cases, you might need to reduce the power to 60% when you get into the yellow zone. At the same time, you might need to have 10% power when you work really close to the red zone. You should remember that you have maximum hydraulic power when you accept the red alert and work in the red zone. When you return to the yellow zone, the system will activate again and change the hydraulic power as needed.
So what I would like to do in the next step is actually define a test case that operators can use out in the field. So we saw the behavior of the system up front. I'm going to make some slight changes here. I want to stay further away from that curb line than I showed in the initial video. So I'm going to select 2 meters. In the yellow trigger distance, I want to be able to work closer to the avoidance without being in the avoidance zone. So I'm going to set that to 5 meters. When we go down to the creep percentage, because I'm now having a shorter distance, I want to be able to ramp the speed down faster. This means I'm going to apply a setting of 30% power ratio. And essentially, by doing that, I have now affected the behavior of the system. And based on that, I would like to demonstrate the difference between what we saw in the beginning of the video versus the behavior of the system when we are working now. So what is expected now is that, firstly, you can see in the Xwatch screen that we don't have any warnings because we are not within any trigger zone. But as soon as I move the machine now and the nearest point of the machine, you can see that the Xwatch system has now said that we have reached an avoidance entry. On MC1, it's very visible that that avoidance is the wall or the curb line in front of us. And I would just like to demonstrate that again. So as I come out of the avoidance, we can then see that the machine will ramp up in power. As soon as I hit the machine into the avoidance zone, the trigger comes and then we ramp the machine down. It's very clear to see that the machine has now stopped a lot further away from the avoidance than we showed in the initial video because we have extended the trigger distance by 1 meter. And with that said, it's as easy as that. So now that we've seen how the system works, it's important to note that an operator is always responsible for safe operation of his machine. Much like some of our driver functions in the automobiles, it's really important to check your surroundings and always best practice. As we showed in the example above, test your avoidance settings against your closest model. That is definitely best practice for any operator. So whilst we wrap up today's session, one quick reminder. In MC1, of course, we know we can change the buckets. If you change the bucket physically, always remember to make the selection in MC1 because we are always measuring specific points on the machine. So that can affect the behavior of the system. That said, now that you know how to configure the system, get out there, use the system, make it a habit, and contribute to an overall safer environment on the worksite.